The frontman of a highly successful band, but where does Paul Heaton get his inspiration? A look at faith and music now, here on ITV1.
The further we feel removed from reality with gadgets and what have you, and different cars and trains speeding us from city to city, the more music can make sense to people who feel as though they're a little bit on the outside of it.
Paul Heaton is a British songwriting institution, the voice of his generation. Paul has number one hits with two bands, the House Martins and the Beautiful South. He's sold over 15 million records, and with writing partner Dave Rothery, is one half of the most successful songwriting duo since Lennon and McCartney.
Music, I suppose, is the concrete pillar to a lot of people's lives, as is, you know, politics and religion to some others. So it's an always there for a lot of people, which is why it's so important. And with me, it's an always been there and always will, sort of thing. Of my pencil
case. Paul Heaton's first number one was an a cappella version of the gospel song Caravan of Love.
I always see a cappella as, I mean, rightly, as church music. It is church music. It has its origins in field music and tribal music and church music. I've got a big collection of sermons. And so we were quite influenced by the imagery of gospel and the church.
The House Martins started the career of two superstar performers. Not just Paul, but his old friend Norman Cook, aka Fatboy Slim. Stand up, stand up. From the highest
mountain valley low, we'll join together. We did use, we definitely used religious imagery. I had a skinhead at the time, and I used to scratch really out a razor blade across into the side of my head. First shock, really, first shock value. The place in which we were born, so neglected and torn apart. Every woman, every man,
join the caravan of love. Stand up. Paul Heaton has never been afraid to shock. His political views cost the House Martins sales and a Christmas number one in 1986.
What really got us knocked off number one, and what lost us the coveted, to certain people, number one Christmas spot, was my outburst at Margaret Thatcher on live on BBC Radio 1 to a week previously to the charts, where I'd suggested that she could do something involving, you know, I don't know, Dennis Thatcher or a horse, I can't remember which one. And it was taken off air straight away. So I think people who thought we were religious perhaps questioned which religion we were from when they maybe listened to the live broadcast.
Paul Heaton has always been a songwriter first and a pop star second. Throughout his career, he has stuck to his own principles. What comes first is the music.
I naturally write too much to fit into a melody. I always overwrite in my songs and try and cut things out and cut it down. So the lyrics are written first. And once they're written, I'm sat with Dave or previously Stan, I just want to make the best sort of possible tune, really. I don't want a dreary tune. And no matter what the song's about, whether it's a dreary message or it's a political message or it's a fun message, I just want to get a good tune for it. And that's something that's come from my background, I suppose.
Paul David Heaton was born in the Wirral in May 1962. Paul's father was football mad, and Paul and his two brothers were focused on sport, not music, as children.
It wasn't really a musical family. There was no musical instrument in the house at all. I remember sort of being asked to join the choir and wasn't encouraged to do so, sort of thing. I had quite a sweet, angelic voice when I was young, but wasn't followed up.
Paul's parents deliberately moved their children away from religion and the influence of the church.
My mum was brought up as a Christadelphian. She hated it. My mum sort of rebelled against it and saw it as a lot of nonsense, really. So I wasn't christened, and none of us were christened. My mum didn't believe in washing away that particular sin. And we weren't encouraged to go to church either.
After a happy early childhood in Sheffield, Paul's father's work moved the Heatons to Surrey, where Paul didn't settle well at school. Being a northerner made him different.
We got a lot of attention, and I definitely, as a result, became an attention seeker and liked the attention. But I didn't really do very well at school, really. I told my mum and dad I was doing O-levels, and they went to this parents' meeting and came back and said, Mrs. Hooton says you're not doing any O-levels at all. And I just I said, lies, like that. The end of school was really bad for me. Me and a few mates, our behaviour was pretty outrageous, really, and it was sort of like setting off fire alarms and riding into assembly on motorbikes and throwing bricks at teachers and all that sort of stuff. It was terrible, really. I got a letter, you know, to my mum and dad saying about my behaviour, of course, which I'd denied, along with the not taking O-levels. I had to promise my mum and dad, you know, because I'd lied to them. I mean, it was unbelievable. Like, I don't know how I thought I was going to get away with it, but because I'd lied to them, I said, I'll go to, not really sit them, but, you know, like, go to college and sit exams and that.
Paul went on to Redhill Technical College to get some O-levels, but his main interest was music. He began writing songs and cut his first record, an album track on a now rare compilation LP. The band was called Tools Down.
I'll turn it up. A good drum entry on this by Stuart. Proper class. I'd always written lyrics at school. I didn't know why. I'd just written things down, you know, like in terms of poetry or stories or whatever, and shown them to people. We did about a handful of about 10 gigs, which I enjoyed, and I think Stuart the drummer enjoyed, but my brother and his friend John Box didn't really like playing in front of people. It was just being a hobby to them. But I saw it as a bit of a chance, I suppose. It's embarrassing hand claps that are on all demos at the time. It's me and my brother harmonising that. Yeah, well, it's sort of embarrassing, but I suppose any record you make, you shouldn't be too embarrassed, because it was just the time that you were in at the time.
Now a recording artist, Paul had the music bug. He also hoped to give up the office job he'd drifted into after college.
So I formed another band, which was with John and Norman Cook, playing sort of guitars and trombone and trumpet, and singing in harmony. And I really enjoyed it, and I sort of packed in work to do that. But then they all went to college, which I was a bit gutted about, really, because I thought I was still in a sort of punk day when you didn't go to college, you know. I thought it was all about rejecting. I'm not having a go at them for doing so, but I suppose with me 3 O-levels or whatever I had, I might have been a bit jealous, I don't know. So I sort of travelled around Europe for a bit and then came back and decided I want to move back up north.
Paul moved to Hull on impulse after visiting the city in 1983.
We picked up a local paper, Hull Daily Mail, and had a look at place and put a deposit down. We only looked through the letterbox. We didn't actually go inside, but we said it'd be all right. So we moved up there.
Paul settled into Grafton Street and advertised for members of a new band, the House Martins. Left-wing politics was important to Paul. Living through the miners' strike and being in Hull at a time of social upheaval and industrial decline hardened Paul's views. The House Martins would sing with Paul's socialist voice.
I was definitely becoming more political with my songwriting. As the miners' strike had worn on through '85, I was sort of incensed, really, about the lack of justice that I felt, you know. So I became very politicised.
Paul worked the House Martins hard, and gradually they became excellent live performers.
I suppose I pushed them quite hard, really. I feel sort of quite bad about that, looking back. But I suppose that's eventually what got us our record contract and our sort of popularity, really.
The House Martins' first release was an important track for Paul. With a pop melody set against hard-edged lyrics, Flag Day showcased Paul's heart-on-his-sleeve approach to morality and political conscience.
The first line said it all, too many Florence Nightingales, not enough Robin Hoods, and I elaborated on that during the song.
Too many Florence Nightingales, not enough Robin Hoods. Too many halos, not enough heroes, coming up with the goods.
It must be one of my first sort of attempts to write a political song. I suppose the sentiment behind the song is it's anti-charity, really, or anti-charity as an excuse, and anti-charity as a political answer, because charity has never answered the question of why people are living in poverty.
It's a waste of time.
I sort of knew at the back of my mind, if John Peel ever heard us, I could trust him to sort of like us. I had no illusions that he was going to be a massive fan, but I just thought he'd like us. And we got a phone call coming through saying, oh yeah, John Peel's playing Flag Day tonight.
With John Peel supporting the House Martins, the hits started to flow. The band also changed. Bass player Ted Key left and was replaced by Paul's old friend Norman Cook. Now Fatboy Slim.
Well, this is The Clash. That's Run DMC. And if you glue them together, you get Clash DMC.
1986 cemented their stardom. Happy Hour peaked at number two.
Happy Hour and a few other songs on the first album and the first songs I wrote with Stan were probably drawing on the experiences I had in the office. For somebody like me, who's a natural fidget and a bit eccentric, really, especially as a 17, 18-year-old. It was torture.
It's happy, I'm again. I think I might be happy if I wasn't out with them and they're happy. It's a love and place to be. Happy that the fire's full of bomb and it's a shield. With a haircut, smile, and the meaning of style is a night I'm with the boss. But you win or you lose, and it's them who choose. And if you don't win, then you've lost.
Yeah, I think it's sort of about that, like, lunchtime culture of going to the pub and sort of ogling over the women out of accounts or out of sales ledger department or whatever, and I hated it.
A good place to be. Don't believe a hack. Speak a different language, trying to sound really hard to me. Don't believe a hack. Oh no, 'cause it's never been.